and kicking tin cans. So all this horror stuff, it didn't come in. We didn't read about that kind of stuff. In the newspaper, we might read a cartoon, Grin and Bear It. Something like that. The violence was not in it. It wasn't in our daily living. But nowadays, innocent as you may be, go to college, study for the exam, stay up all night, pass, then get a job, and on your way to the job, get pulled over for changing lane. As a consequence, your life is snuffed out. Many of us don't know exactly what happened at this. So you live a life a lot of times, and all day long, question mark. All day long, question mark. See somebody on the street, how you feel? Okay. You ask yourself, do they mean that? Question mark. I was on the plane yesterday, and it was chilly. And I turned up my coat collar on the plane, and a woman sitting beside me of another persuasion, she and her husband, and after a while she said, you're cold, aren't you? I said, yes, I am. She says, I am too. So she reached down in her little bag there and pulled out one of those old-time
quilts,
plain blankets. You know, they're small, but they're very warm.
Right.
She pulled it out and she spread it over herself, and then she leaned over to me and said, why don't you get under the blanket with me?
That's pastor's friend.
I didn't get to be 90 years old making bad decisions. I said, thank you, honey, but I think I'm going to be warm. out of all of the hatred in the life.
Come on, preacher.
Every once in a while, here's somebody.
Yeah.
Of a different persuasion.
Yeah.
Who offers to share their blanket with you.
Right.
well, Job, it appears, had lost most everything that he had. We know the story of the Lord meeting with some of his people, and there comes a man in, and the Lord asks him, where have you been? What is your story? And he says, I've been to and fro seeking whom I may destroy. And some of these people that claim they're following you, they're not real. And I've discovered if I do certain things, I can make all of them lose their allegiance to you and not believe in it. So the Lord said, well, I got one man, Job, that I don't believe you can deal with. Oh, yes, he said, I take his stuff. So he took his stuff and came back. They had another meeting, and the Lord said, you back? He said, yes. How'd you come out with Job? He said, well, I didn't quite get him, but that's because I didn't bother his body. I just took his money and his crops and his mule and his asses and so forth. But if I get to his body, I'll get him. There's somewhere I can cause any man to lose his trust in you. God said, no, I don't think that's so. I'm telling you, there are some who trust me.
Yes, sir.
And, Job said, well, let me get to his body. And God said, well, okay, if you want to do that, but don't mess with his soul.
Right.
I can't go that far. You can go ahead and eat with his body. So he causes sores and boils and all of that stuff. And finally, when he's done all of that, Job's friends, his friends, not his enemies, his friends, come to him in an attempt to console him. And said, Job, I know God himself said you're a perfect and upright man. But you must have done something. You must have done something. Now, there seems to be in life a little truth in most of what is a lie.
Hmm.
Of come read, there seems to be a little snag of truth in them. I think that's what gets us up sometimes. Because after we become a new creation in Christ, our first belief is always, you failed. You're nice to me. That's a Christian new creation. Before you're created anew in Christ, your first feeling is suspicion. I don't trust you.
Right.
Trying to run a game on.
Right.
But once you become a Christian, your first impulse is always, we sister, we brother.
Right.
That's what that new creation is about. You lose suspicion after something has happened. Then you say, I should have known this or that or the other. And so Satan comes in and he works with Job. And Job's friends say, now, Job, you must have done something for this to have happened. God would not just do this to you or allow Satan to do this to you. Job, after listening to their discussion, says to himself, now, maybe I better reason this out a little bit myself. But I noticed one thing. He says, now, ordinarily, when you sin, there is a consequence.
Right, right.
But I'm not complimenting myself, but I don't know of any sins that I've done willfully.
Right.
I didn't plan any sin.
Right.
I may have, but I didn't plan it.
Come on, preacher.
And it just seemed like to me that with a real God, that he wouldn't do this to me, He wouldn't do this to me. He said himself that I'm honest and upright. In fact, he called me perfect.
Right.
At some stages in the game. I just don't quite understand it. How he can be such a fair God.
Yeah.
And yet cause this to happen to me. If it happens to somebody that's low down and wicked and sinful,
Lord,
I might go along with that.
Huh.
Even though he's a gracious and loving and forgiving God. But to deal with me like this, and then my friends now, they're turning on me and saying that there must be something wrong with me. But Job finally, in his reasoning, no wonder the Bible says, come now, let us reason together.
Right.
Job finally says, well, if I reason a little bit, it's strange to me that he will let something come almost to die.
Huh.
Take a tree, for instance. He said, it can die. It can die. And yet, from the smell of water.
Huh.
Smell.
And they say water has no smell.
If God is fair.
Huh.
And he will provide for birds and foxes.
Yeah.
They've never been to school.
Ha.
Yet a bird is an engineer. He knows how to make a nest.
All right, all right.
Ha. How much straw to get.
Ha. Yeah, how big he wanted.
And nobody tutored him. But a bird can make a nest.
Come on, preacher.
And a fox can know where to go in a hole.
Yeah. All right.
Looked like he would be fair to me.
Right, right.
And so Job begins to reason to himself. That's what I'm talking about this morning. That's my introduction. I'm almost through. Job says to himself, with all that I've lost, I believe I still have enough going for me.
Yeah.
That's the message I want to bring to you this morning. Regardless of what you've lost, has slipped out of your hands. And regardless of what they say, this is your last day on the job. And we're relocating you and all that. And your house needs a new roof and a new gutter. And you got asbestos in it. You've been living there for years. You've been breathing in and out of it. And you never had a headache or anything about it until they told you it's asbestos. You're supposed to have some sinus problems. You just been blowing your nose, bro. But Job reasons and says, if God is faithful and has created the heaven and earth and made provision for animals and for trees and bushes, surely.
Yes, yes, yes.
If he cares about man, then there must be something, there must be a point of saving, salvation. There must be some point of resurrection. There must be the blessing of a foul ball.
Ah.
I was hitting against Satchel Paige one day, one Sunday afternoon in Montreal. He threw me 13 pitches. I fouled off 13 pitches. Now, three strikes is supposed to make you out.
Yeah, yeah.
But a foul ball saved.
Ha. Make it plain.
My life. How many
make
times?
It plain. Yeah. Yeah.
I've been washed out.
Hey.
But a foul ball.
Yes, sir.
My Lord.
My Lord.
Peter should have struck out the way he did and went back and denied Jesus. One woman said, I know you were with him. I saw you with him. Peter said, no, not me. Two strikes. Jesus, the girl said, and said, you've been with him. Said, you act like him. Peter said, no, I don't know him. I don't know him. That's right, too. And the girl said, you talk like him. You act like him. Strike three. Peter said, I told you, I don't know him. Foul ball. When the Lord got up and told Mary to go tell the disciples.
Come on, preacher.
Meet me in Galilee and Peter.
Yes, sir.
I said to myself, you don't want to see Peter. I said, he struck out. He said, no, he just foul ball.
All right. All right. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And in your life and in my life, I'm living on foul ball.
Hey!
There's a foul ball.
Yes, sir.
Who said no slavery?
Yes, sir.
Yes, will I trust? That's what Job said.
Hallelujah.
Almost true. But he said if he could take care of the birds and the foxes.
Yeah, yeah.
If he could take care of these other creatures. It must be.
It must be.
That he's going to leave some way.
Yes.
Some mind.
Yes.
For us who were created in his image.
Yeah.
That's the first thing. That's the first thing you want to keep in mind. Whatever your situation is, however low you may get, whatever you may lose, just say to yourself, if I'm created in his image, I must have some of his eternity. So if God is real and eternal, it means if you're in him, there's some no dying in you, however long you live and whatever you do. There's always something in you that's still alive. Still alive. I wish I could make you know that like I know it. I'm telling you, storms may rise.
Yeah, yeah.
Wind may blow. But there's still something in you that's holding on. Whatever your situation.
Yes,
be.
God. Yes, God.
So he says, we're made in God's image. There's something always in our lives that can never be completely extinguished.
Ah.
Secondly, we may need to remember that the sins of this world, crime and mistreatment and wickedness, are not of God's making. They are of God's grace because he allows us to mess up the combinations in life. Whiskey is good, they tell me. and all this other stuff. But when you mix that up with a green,
all right, preacher.
A bad combination. You cannot say anything that God made is bad.
Right, right.
Can't say that. He's a good God.
Right, right.
How could he make something bad?
Yeah.
He's good all by himself.
Yeah.
In his totality.
Yes. So yes.
Bad he can do.
In his totality.
But when you make a combination of something.
Come on, preacher.
You can take anything and make it bad.
Yeah.
You can take a church house and make it bad.
Yeah.
Yeah. You lie in the church if you want to. Combination of something. But you cannot blame God.
Right.
For what? Is a bad combination. So Job is saying, these things have come upon me, and God has allowed Satan to work his combinations on me. And I think once you get that in life, then you don't blame God for getting over.
Amen. Amen.
You don't blame God for losing your head. Deal with that this morning. People doing a whole lot of stuff to try to replace what God has.
Yeah. Come on, preacher.
No, I'm gonna be nice, but I got 5 minutes to go. But I'm in my text.
All right.
Because my text says.
Come on, preacher.
Job says. With just a sip of water,
yeah,
a thing can be revived. So if the Lord takes your hand,
come on, preacher,
he's gonna keep your mustache. Ah, you got your eyebrows.
All right.
There always gonna be some hair somewhere.
All right.
Hey. Whether you lose tonight, God always has something else.
Right.
You can hold on to.
Yes, sir.
That's what Job is saying. I'm through now. Finally, Job is saying, if a tree only needs a scent of water, a scent, not a drink of water, not a hose of water. I understand they're finding some people out here for using water on days that they're not supposed
right,
to be doing it.
Right.
Job says in his text, if your life is in God, you don't need all of that other stuff to make it through.
Right.
If a tree can go down and the limb break off and the trunk become weak and so forth, if the root is still there, just the scent of water.
Yes, sir.
Not the water.
Yes, sir.
Not the water.
Come on, preacher.
Just the scent.
Yes, sir.
Just the thought about water. Just the realization to know that God is still with you. Will make you able to sprout again.
Yes, sir.
I'm through now. That's how I'm living, like I'm living at the age I'm getting.
All right.
I don't have the strength I used to have. Your pastor may not have what he used to have. I remember when he could prance up to the plate, take a few strokes, and go on through with the ball. But now I see him feeling for the rail on the wall, looking down when he goes. But the scent of water.
Come on, preacher.
But knowing that the thinking about God will make you able when everything is broken down. Job said, I don't have to have the water, just the scent of water. If I can smell, God will make me able.
Yes, sir.
Praise his name. I trust in God. I know he cares for me. On earth is me. On the stormy sea, they put Job's brother in the pit. One version says they sold him, went down in Egypt, put him in prison. But in prison, just the scent of being free.
Right, right,
he
right.
He changed what brought him there. He remembered the God who had kept him all those days. And he lived on hopes and dreams. When you know him for yourself.
Come on, preacher.
You can lose your job.
Yes,
you
sir.
You can lose your house. You can lose your car. But you won't lose transportation.
Right.
Just the center of it. God has provided.
Yes, sir.
If he sent his son to die for us, you know we're more important than the birds and the foxes and whatever else is out there. God God so loved the world.
Yeah.
He gave his only begotten Son. Whosoever believeth in him should not perish. May not almost, but not perish.
Yeah.
But have everlasting life.
Yeah.
I'm going on with Jesus.
I know you're right.
The same. I'm through now. But the Lord is good, I tell you.
Yes, he
is. I'm giving off the scent. I don't have to stop, but just the scent of it, the aroma of it, the thought that God is with me, makes me able to go through. May the Lord bless you. You're here this morning. Don't give up. I don't care what the situation may look like. Don't throw in the towel. I don't care how rough it gets. Just think about it. Just the scent of water. God will make a tree able to bloom again. There's a better day ahead.
Yeah.
There's some time to quit, I tell you. Soul is happy.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm living off friendship. I'm living off kinship.
Yeah.
I'm living off fellowship. I'm living off fellowship. I'm living off hopes and dreams. I know God will. God will. God will take care of you.